has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning and welcome to this 8:30 service here at Highland Park United Methodist Church. We are so grateful to have you with us, whether you've joined us in person or you're joining us online. We are glad you are here. Please stand as you are able and join us in our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Please remain standing as we join together to affirm our faith with the historic words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Well, a very good morning to all of you gathered here in the sanctuary of Highland Park United Methodist Church. We are delighted, maybe more than ever, after a trying week of weather in the city. It is such a blessing to see all of you here in worship. I also want to take a minute to welcome all of you watching online. So many of you each and every week choose to worship and participate with us in that way, and we are very, very blessed that you do so. I hope you let us know that you're doing that. There's a little area on there you can click and register your attendance, but the more important thing there is we don't want you just to watch. We want you to really feel connected to the church. If there's any way we could be praying for you, for your family, for your loved ones over the course of the next week, it is always a privilege to do that. We have a whole team of staff and of volunteers and of clergy that love to pray for you each and every week, so we would love to know how we might be able to do that. We have one goal, and we say it every week. For those of you online, those of you here physically, it's the same. We hope to draw you a little nearer to Christ than you were when you came and when you sat down. That's it. It's been a very, very trying week. I know so many of you, we've been on the phone with many of you. You've had all kinds of problems with pipes and water and loss of electricity and sleeping in the cold. And, of course, the city has been ravaged by this, but this church has really, really stepped up. So I just want to let you know a little bit about some things that we've done this week to try to lend a helping hand. More than 3,900 meals left the walls of this church to go help those with the greatest in need at the Dallas Convention Center, at their shelter and their emergency shelter. We have funded significantly that same shelter, the convention center, in a partnership with Oaklawn Methodist Church and with Austin Street Shelter. One of the things we did, Genesis Women's Center, which we've supported for a long, long time, was without power and had to relocate all of their clients. It was a tough situation, an emergency situation, and we've helped to fund new generators for them, so that will never happen in the future. And on a few days ago, we were so blessed to have the Tollison Building open as a warming center for the community. And then one of the things that I really loved was that we had a team of folks that reached out to over 700 of the most vulnerable in our own congregation just to find out how they were doing and to see what their needs are. And we were able to meet not only the needs of the city, but so many of the needs of our community of folks that were really, really struggling. I say all that just to thank you for your extraordinary generosity and to let you know in a moment as we call for our offering, as we do every week, all 100% of anything that comes the way of the church this week will go directly into the community in terms of disaster relief from this storm. So I hope you know that as the offertory begins here in just a minute. We always want to do what we can for the community, the city of Dallas. This has been a tough, tough situation, and there's going to be a lot of impact that has yet to be revealed. A lot of folks without food, a lot of folks without shelter still, and we want to do our best to help as a church. So thank you so much for your extraordinary generosity. And now's the time. I'll call for ushers. We don't have ushers here physically now. We don't take up an offering because of COVID with an old-fashioned plate, but on the back of all the pew backs, there's what we call a QR code. You can shoot a picture of that with your phone. If you're online, you'll see the link as well. You'll go digitally directly to the church's website, and please, again, just know that everything that comes our way this week does not stay here. It goes directly into the community to help those most vulnerable. So thank you so much for all you do, and we're blessed that you're here this morning for worship. Thank you.
You may be seated. Please bow in prayer with me. Lord, we believe in you, our shepherd, as you care and watch over us. We pray for our friends sifting through the effects of the weather event this week. Lord, as a church, we have reached out and provided assistance to those in need, but we ask you to care for lives in ways that we cannot. So many are left with anxieties and burdens. We ask you to sustain all of us and provide us with rest as we need it. Lord, as we prepare to face another week, we know and declare always that you are with us. Lord, we thank you for your gracious, loving hand that guides us along our path. When life brings uncertainty, you remain steady and sure. And we have relied on your love and your provision for every day of our life. Our hope is in you alone. We will remain faithful to you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We know that you will remain faithful to us. Now let us pray the words that he has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
One thing I forgot to mention in the announcement section is I wanted to reintroduce to some of you, maybe introduce for the first time to some of you, Camille May. Reverend Camille May is with us this morning. We are delighted. Camille's been with us now for a couple of years, but she's been mostly behind the scenes. But I tell you, she runs our pastoral care department. She is on the front lines, as you all well know. The mark of any great church has nothing to do with the content and the volume of its programs. It has everything to do with its people. And she is among the best and brightest, and we're so blessed that she's on our staff. And she shows up every day trying to figure out how she can help this congregation. And Carla Nivens as well is part of our impact ministry. And she's been on the front lines all week trying to help those the greatest of needs. I'm going to shift gears a little bit. I know you don't have a hard copy of your bulletin in your hand, but if you're watching online, you will have a digital version of that bulletin, and it's going to have a scripture that I'm not going to read and a sermon title that I'm not going to address. So I just don't want you to get too confused as I start off in a different direction. But when I was thinking about something this week that popped up in my head, when I was a kid, about 10 or 11 years old, I don't really remember the year, sometime in the mid-70s, my father took me to California. I'd never been to California, was kind of enamored with it. You saw California on the television. You saw California in the movies, and I had never been. And we had a lot of fun out there. And one of the things he took me to do, he said, son, I want to take you to Universal Studios. I said, what's Universal Studios? He goes, that's where they make all the magic and the miracle of movie making, and you can see how they make movies. I was so excited. I didn't know what to expect. But when we got there, they passed out a brochure. And immediately there were two kind of, I don't know if they're called exhibits or whatever they're called. I wanted to see two things. I wanted to see the shark from Jaws. That was a big deal. I knew they had a shark from Jaws there, and you get on this little tram, and they take you by this little lagoon. A shark pops up. I couldn't wait to see the shark from Jaws. And the other thing I wanted to see was the Red Sea, where Charlton Heston in the movie The Ten Commandments parted the Red Sea. And I had seen that movie. We'd watch it every, almost comes on around Easter time. I'd watch it every single year with my family, and I thought, I want to see where they parted the Red Sea. That's got to be cool. So we saw the shark. That was a lot of fun. And then we pulled up to another little lagoon, and the little host on our tram started telling us about Charlton Heston and the movie The Ten Commandments and how it was made and how they parted the Red Sea. And we got to this lagoon, and then you stop, and it's full of water, and you can't go anywhere. And it's probably a teenager for a summer job or something. This lady was on the mic, and she said, all right, here's what I want everybody to do. Stretch out your hands like Moses. And everybody stretched out their hands like Moses. Point them to the water. Stretch them out as far as you can. And in unison, on the count of three, I want everybody to say, part the waters. One, two, three. And everybody said, part the waters. And nothing happened. Not one thing. And she obviously did not have a response written in her script about what to do if nothing happened. So she said, stretch him out even further. And we're going to say it even louder this time. On the count of three, part the waters. One, two, three. Part the waters. And everybody yelled it at the top of their voice. And we sat there and we waited anxiously. And I couldn't wait to see the Red Sea part. And nothing happened. Not one thing happened. I don't know if it broke. I don't know if it was just inoperable. I don't know what happened, but I know she started scrambling out of embarrassment. And finally, she just said, I guess the first thing that came to her mind, she said, well, it looks like God is not in the mood for a miracle today. And so we did not get to see the Red Sea part. We had to drive around it. And I remember as a little boy, frustrated, thinking, wait a minute, where's my miracle? I came to see a miracle. Where's my miracle? And we stopped, and they started talking all about the movie, and they wanted you to have reverence for that spot, reverence for what happened in that spot. But it wasn't the same without the experience. You could know what had happened there. You could understand what had happened there. But without the experience of the sea actually parting, it was a big, giant letdown. I wanted to know, where was my miracle? Now, we love a good miracle story. We love it. And we've invited the whole congregation to read through the book of Exodus, and you'll find out about how Moses parted the Red Sea in history when you read it. And I just want to read you a little passage from there to kind of set up a context for this question: what do we do when it looks like we're not going to get our miracle? Chapter 6, verse 1, now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh. This is Moses. This is Charlton Heston talking to the people of Israel. You shall see what I do to Pharaoh. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I've remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. Now, here is the context. These people had been slaves for generations, for over 400 years. The Israelites held captive in bondage for four centuries. And now Moses has the audacity to say, buckle up, watch what I can do in the name of God. You're about to see a bunch of miracles. And sure enough, what you've read this week, if you've been joining us, and if you haven't started this, it's not too late. I really want to invite you to pick up the book of Exodus and read along with us, because it's pretty exciting stuff. And through a series of miracles, Moses does what he said he would do. God works through Moses. He wreaks havoc on Pharaoh. You probably remember this as a kid. He turns all their rivers and water to blood. He sends a whole plague of frogs, a whole plague of gnats, a whole plague of flies. He infects everybody in the Egyptian side with boils. He calls upon hail and storms to wreak havoc on the land. He orders locusts to take over their crops. And all of this happens. And finally, after what we call the Passover, he leads 600,000 Israelites, former slaves, out of bondage, headed to the promised land. And you get to that epic scene, that one they try to get you to have reverence for at Universal Studios, where you get to the Red Sea, and behind all the Israelites, here comes Pharaoh, angry that he had been duped. And all of those chariots and all of those horses, and they're swinging all those things with the spikes on them, and they're coming after him. In front of them is the Red Sea. And Moses stretches out his hand, and you know the rest of the story. The Red Sea begins to part. Now, this is the part we love. We love it when God shows up and shows off through a miracle. We love it when God does what we know and believe that he's capable of doing. We love it when we discover the scope of God's power. And we love it when he honors his supernatural forces through this thing called miracles. But when you read on in Exodus, what you will find is after that miraculous parting of the Red Sea, it will not be long until those same Israelites begin to ask the same question: where is my miracle now? Because as you'll find out as you read on the rest of the story, they crossed the Red Sea. when they get to the other side of the Red Sea. Moses turns, he stretches out his arm once again. The Red Sea closes and destroys the entire Egyptian army under Pharaoh's watch. But now you have the Israelites stranded in the desert. Whereas if you will recall, they remain for 40 years. There's another generation that comes along, 40 years. And though it has not been long since the Red Sea was parted, they now find themselves frustrated. And they find themselves asking the question, we know what God's capable of doing, we've heard about it, but where is my miracle? Have you ever asked that question in your own life? I mean, you've seen a miracle in someone else's life, and you've got one of those friends, and they prayed for healing and healing and healing, and lo and behold, they got a great medical report. But you've prayed for healing for a loved one over and over and over, and it never came. They passed away. Maybe you know one of your girlfriends who took a risk. You've been praying for her to get out of a relationship, and she took that bold risk and left that relationship and immediately was rewarded by another relationship. And this one looked like the son of Brad Pitt, except this one had memorized all the New Testament and was everything that we hoped somebody would be. And yet you've been praying the same prayer since you took the same risk and not a single date. And you're wondering, where is God in my life? Where is my miracle? What do you do when you find yourself disappointed in God? What do you do when maybe you feel like God has let you down? What do you do when you've dreamt of having that baby and you have prayed for having that baby and the baby never came? What do you do when you have dreamt of marriage over and over and over? God, put someone in my life that I can love and that will love me back. Bring me into a prosperous relationship. And it never seems to come. What do you do when you've heard your pastor say, pray big and pray bold? And so you prayed big and you prayed bold, but nothing happened. What do you do? We all have reverence for God, don't we? But wouldn't it be true that even though we have reverence for God, there are some times when we get disappointed, we get angry, we get frustrated, maybe we even hold a little bit of a grudge because God doesn't do what we know God can do. God doesn't do for us what we've heard God can do. God doesn't do for us what we've read in the scriptures that God has done over and over and over. Why has he not shown up for me? And you want to trust God, and you've got so much reverence for God, but you're finding it difficult. Because God could, but he won't. God can, but he hasn't. And when we're real truthful, sometimes we have a little low-grade anger and we just get frustrated and we hold on to a grudge. And last week we talked about the power of letting go of grudges we hold against the people in our lives. And so today what I want to do is talk about what do you do when that grudge is not against other people in your life, but it's in the very God for whom you have so much reverence. What do we do when we need to reconcile with God? What do we do when we feel like we've been wronged? What do we do when we need to trust God, but yet God doesn't seem to be giving us our miracle? Some years after the Exodus, the scriptures introduces us to, I think, probably one of the best personable and most relatable examples of exactly what happened to the Israelites. And in 1 Samuel, we're introduced to a woman named Hannah. She had a husband named Elkanah. And Elkanah, the name in Hebrew means God created a son. So Elkanah by name believed that God was going to provide him a son. So he marries Hannah. He assumes that God will give them a son, but Hannah can't bear a child. And they try over and over and over and over. They know what God can do, but God has chosen not to do it for whatever reason. And they get frustrated. And so Elkanah marries a second woman. Her name is Peninnah. You can only imagine what it's like to have not one, but two wives under the same roof. There's quite a rivalry there. It's quite frustrating. You can imagine Hannah's internal dialogue. She cannot have a child, and yet Peninnah shows up pregnant. And now you got all kind of chaos under the same roof. And Hannah feels like a failure, in particular in this culture when women were only called upon to give birth to children. You can imagine how useless she must have felt. It must have been easy for her to ask God, God, where is my miracle? As the story evolves, they travel every year to a place called Shiloh for a celebration, for worship, and for sacrifice. And every time they would travel, it would be Elkanah, and it would be Penina, and it would be Hannah. And sitting in the back seat of the old Ford Econoline van, there would be Penina throwing shade at her sister Hannah. Listen to this passage from 1 Samuel 1. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival Penina kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not and could not eat. Now, my hunch is for some of you this morning, those words year after year mean something. Because you've been begging God to do something for you miraculous year after year. You want your marriage to get better, but year after year, it just seems to get worse. Here we have Hannah, sweet and godly Hannah. She has done everything right, everything compliant, everything faithful. And yet it is the cruel, vicious Penina who turns up pregnant. You can imagine Hannah, why bless her and not me? I've been faithful. I've done everything right. I have prayed. I have believed. I have waited. I have served. I have taught Sunday school. I give to the church. All of this stuff. And yet, where are you, God, in my life? Year after year, Hannah believed. She prayed. And she waited year after wrenching year. Is there anyone here this morning, any one of you online, that can relate? You believe, you have reverence, you've prayed, and you've waited. You've waited for that relationship. You've waited for a job with benefits. You've waited for healing for yourself or healing for a loved one. You've waited for a prodigal child to come home. And you know God can, but it seems as God won't. And you know God is capable, but he hasn't. And you don't know why, and it goes year after year, and year after year, you've wanted your depression to go away, and you know God can do that, but year after year, you find yourself fighting just to get to the end of the day. Year after year, you've been consumed with financial hardship, and you just want to break free from debt, and you're always behind year after year. And so you wake up and you're wondering, God, where are you? Where is my miracle? I trusted you. I pray to you. I wait for you, and yet you haven't done it. If you've ever felt like this, I'm telling you, this is what the Israelites felt like not long after perhaps one of the greatest miracles of all time. This is what Hannah felt like year after year. And her husband, Elkanah, you'd think he could help out, but husbands, come on, have you ever asked your wife, let's just be frank, a stupid question? Year after year, she's struggling. She can't even eat. She's weeping. Listen to this, 1 Samuel 1:8. Her husband, Elkanah, would say to her, Hannah, why are you crying? Why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? No, the scripture doesn't tell us how Hannah responded. But you can probably figure it out. She's doing everything she can to trust in God. The only thing she wants can only be given by God. She's disappointed, and her husband is such a knucklehead, he just says, why are you crying? I'm better than 10 children. And it just gets worse and worse and worse. What in the world do we do when we're begging God, where is our miracle? Well, this is why this story is so relatable, because this is exactly what Hannah does. You know what she does? She unloads on God. She unloads on God, and this is something I think we ought to feel provisioned and have permission to do. We don't do it every day. It's not like this is leads our prayer life every day, but every now and then, did you know it's okay just to let it rip and just to unload on God? Listen, once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now, Eli, the priest, was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house, and in her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, check this out, weeping bitterly. And that word bitterly is so powerful. See, sometimes we weep in joy, but no, she's weeping bitterly. Why? Because she's holding a grudge against God. She's in deep anguish. She's crying bitterly. I've always prayed, I've always waited, and now I'm so bitter. So she pours the heat on. She just lets know God everything that she's feeling from A to Z. She pulls no punches. She holds nothing back. She tells him everything that you feel. If you ever find yourself disappointed with God, you know it's okay to let God know. You know you can get on your knees and you can weep bitterly. And you can tell God, I don't understand. David did that. Jeremiah did that. Did not Jesus do that on the cross? Where is my miracle? Where is deliverance from the cross? My God, why have you forsaken me? Over and over, we find people in the scriptures saying, I have been faithful. God, why are you pulling back on me? Why do you seem so absent? I believe with all of my heart. And yet you appear to be invisible. But this is what I believe. God can handle your questions. God can handle your fury. In fact, I believe this so much. I believe that God would rather you tell him what's going on in honesty and candor than walk away from him altogether in pain. God would rather you have you on your knees weeping bitterly than deciding to pack it up and say, God, you know what? I don't trust you anymore. You ever find yourself in the situation, you can take it to God. You can take your pain. You can take your grief. You can take your doubts. You can take your questions. Hannah unloaded, and then the deal-making starts. You ever done that? Well, God, you know, you didn't give me my miracle now, but I'll make a deal with you. If you do it, then I'll do this. And she does that. She gets on her knees. She says, here's the deal, God. If you give me a son, I'll give him right back to you. But still, she walks away with nothing tangible. No baby, no pregnancy. Penina is still the golden star in the marriage. What does she do? She unloads on God. And then she does something that I think is so incredibly important. And heaven knows when we've had a week like we've had this week, sometimes this is all you can do. She simply chooses to continue by faith alone. She has not gotten her miracle, but she continues to trust God. She believes that God is still good. She still has reverence for God. She sees nothing from God, but she refuses to believe that God is doing nothing. She sees nothing, but she will not believe that God is doing nothing. And this is one of the most powerful lines in all of Scripture. 1 Samuel 1:19, then, in abject frustration, the entire family got up early the next morning, and they went to worship the Lord. And I love these two words. Once more. They didn't know what to do. So they simply showed up at church, got on their knees when they had doubts, when they had questions, when their miracle still had not been delivered. And they chose to worship the Lord once more. Friends, this is the story of the Bible. This is the story of every character that we revere for their faith. The men and women in our scriptures who teach us about God, they are not the ones who are exempt from adversity. They are always the one who, in the face of adversity, though it seems like God has disappeared on them, continue to worship God once more. They keep showing up. These are the people that bring us our faith. They're not exempt from adversity. Nor are they the ones that just packed their bags and gave up, though they often want to. They simply show up. They are not put off by adversity. They use it as fuel to become more adamant and more passionate about God. And somewhere along the way, all the great characters have decided that just because they see nothing from God doesn't mean that God is not doing something. And simply by faith, they decide to trust God and to hold on. They decide to worship God one more, even when they don't understand, even when they don't get it. Now, this has been a crazy week. So many of our congregation, certainly so many around Dallas, have struggled mightily this week. The impact will be long-lasting. Many of you have endured nights and nights and nights with no heat, no water. We've been feeding people all over this city who have had no access to food. We've had one of our beloved church members gunned down on the freeway senselessly. We've had a teenager who's supposed to have brain surgery but couldn't get there because of the ice on the road. This has been a tough week, but every time we're inclined to say, God, where is our miracle? You know what we do? We show up and we worship God once more. We hang on, we go back, we get on our knees, we sing the songs, we lift up the prayers, we support one another, we don't just have reverence, we go all in. You know why we do that? Because we choose to believe that a waiting season is never a wasted season. Just because we have to wait doesn't mean that we're wasting our time. This is the only argument could make that Moses could make to those Israelites who years after the parting of the Red Sea said, where is my miracle? Why are we still in the desert 40 years later? Why are we still in the heat? Why are we still struggling every single day? And all Moses could do was look them in the eye and say, you know what? I don't know, but a waiting season is not a wasted season. Now, I don't know what's going to happen to you. In Hannah's case, ultimately, she was blessed with pregnancy. Ultimately, God gave her what he had promised that he would do. It may happen to you, it may not happen to you, but either way, I know this. The goodness of God is not based on what we see. It's simply based on who God is. And the presence of adversity never equates the absence of God. There is, in fact, no correlation between God loving you and you and I facing adversity. There is no actual correlation between lack of cooperation on God's part and God's presence or existence or love for us. I'm telling you, friends, if you believe that, you'd be tempted to assume that God doesn't exist because God doesn't cooperate. Then likewise, you'd have to sometimes believe and be tempted to believe that your parents don't exist. Because aren't the best parents not the ones who always deliver what you need when you need it and when you ask for it? The best parents aren't the ones that always say yes in the moment. If it were true that parents didn't exist when parents didn't cooperate, I can promise you my children would be walking around saying, there is no such thing as dad. There is no such thing as dad. There is no such thing as dad. We show up and we worship once more, not because we see God doing, but because in who we believe God is. Now, in Hannah's case, it plays out this way. Then they returned home to Ramah. When Elkanah slept with Hannah, the Lord remembered her plea, and in due time she gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, I asked the Lord for him. And I've circled those words, in due time. Because that's what it all comes down to at the end of the day. You still believe that God will deliver in due time? Do you still believe that God's delays are not exclusively denials? That sometimes we just have to wait for due time to take place? And in the meantime, you have every right, every privilege, every encouragement to get on your knees, to tell God exactly how you feel. Unload on God, but then like Hannah, show up, let go of the grudge, and worship God once more. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it has been a tough week, but it's been a tough life for a lot of folks. There's always such hardship in this world that is so incredibly broken with sin. So much pain, so much suffering, so much agony, yet we show up and we believe in you and we trust in you and we know the miracles that we've read about in scriptures. We know the miracles that we've witnessed and seen in the life of our friends and our neighbors. We know the miracles that our pastors have told us about from the pulpit. We know all of that, but there are days, Lord, when we just wonder, where is our miracle? Lord, just as you did with Hannah, hear our prayer. Allow us just to unload on you and to cry and weep bitterly sometimes. But know this, Lord, we will not stop showing up and worshiping you once more, because we believe that in due time, we'll come to a full understanding of what your grace and mercy are truly all about. In your son's holy name we pray. Amen. I invite all of you now. We're going to stand. We're going to sing our closing hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus. I hope, even if you're watching online, I hope you'll join us as we share together in song.
Please be seated for the benediction and the choral response, and know that after we finish, the ushers will come and will release us row by row. Now bow your head and receive this benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace. And as we go from this place, may we be reminded that God can answer our questions, that we can continue to show up, continue to serve a good and gracious God. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen.